On tonight's Arizona ArtBeat, we take a look at the official state neckwear of Arizona with a bolo tie aficionado named Norman Sandfield. I recently spoke with Sandfield about his tie collection, which is a part of a new exhibit of American Indian bolo ties at the Heard Museum in Phoenix. Norman, thank you so much for joining us on Horizon.
Thank you.
I got it. Before we get into this beautiful neckwear, what got you started into collecting bolo ties?
Well, I avoided them for many years, but a friend of mine bought me a vintage Native American buckle, silver and turquoise, and I finally decided I had to get a bolo to go with it. And I'd left the first shop with two, and two led to three and four, and then I started researching them and looking into them and studying them and turning them over and looking at the backs, which turns out to be an important part of the story. And the next thing I knew, that I was a student of the art form.
I was going to say, was there an aha moment, or just before you knew it, you were knee-deep in bolo ties?
Knee-deep in bolo ties, that's what it is.
Define for us, what is a bolo tie?
At the simplest level, it is an ornament. It does not have to be silver and turquoise. Up front and center on a braided leather cord with some tips, and the tips are functional. They keep the braided leather from unraveling. And you slide it up and down to take it on and off. The higher up you put it on your collar, the more formal it is.
Were there antecedents to bolo ties? Where did they come from? Any inspiration?
Well, they go back. There are similar ties and neckwear. Let's call it neckwear. They go back to the 1870s and 1880s. Men and women were wearing things that looked like bolo ties, as well as scarf slides. And in the Native American community, all along from 1880, 1890, in through the mid-20th century, you have Native Americans wearing various things around their neck that would be a scarf slide, as we would call it today. And then you have the cowboys wearing scarf slides. And somewhere in there, in around 1948, they magically morphed into this from a scarf to a braided leather cord. Anonymous artists doing work in the shops. They weren't listed in catalogs. They weren't listed in advertising. They really didn't appear in printed media until 1954.
Wow, 1954, and just generally in the West?
They started this. No, the advertising actually was national.
Okay.
A non-native company called Hickok out of New York patented a piece very similar to those early native pieces, and they started marketing it with press releases and advertising across the country.
And that's just the general bolo ties we're talking about.
Yes.
Okay, what differentiates the garden variety bolo tie, if you will, from American Indian bolo ties?
Well, they've both developed into a very high-end art form. They started out as very simple keystone-shaped pieces, maybe an inch high, with a simple leather cord, nothing fancy. And then they ended up using those keystone-shaped pieces as the backings and putting larger and larger elements on the front. And whether it's made by a native artist or a non-native artist, it doesn't matter. In Japan, they're made out of wood. The Hakone region is famous for its woodwork, and it's very distinctive, and they have some very fine pieces. There are lacquer pieces and Damascene pieces from Japan, very similar to Damascene pieces from Spain. There's bolo ties from Australia that have jade in them. In America, in the Midwest, you've got beaded bolo ties.
You
go to Alaska, and you have fossilized ivory.
Interesting. Now, and you've brought some bolo ties with you here, and there's one on this neck stand that is absolutely gorgeous. Tell us about the craftsmanship. What are we looking at here?
You're looking at a beautiful piece by Richard Sosi. It is tufa cast and textured with little grains of silver, which he has sort of made a texture out of it by adding it after it's cast. And these added inlays in there, I believe, I can't see it from here, some coral and turquoise and fossil ivories.
And this was, is this a recently
this
made?
This is brand new in
brand
the last
new
year.
Bolo tie.
Yes.
So the bolo tie is hardly a dying art form, is it?
Oh, it's not a dying art form. It's been around. It's just been quiet for a few years. If you go to the TV shows, you'll see it on Glee. Two of the characters on Glee have worn bolos.
Yeah.
You see it on other TV shows in this past year, A Burn Notice, and I forget the name of the other one.
Well, that's all right. You said enough already as far as the modern element. I want to get back to the ties here. You got a couple here with you as well. Describe what we're looking at there.
This is a beautiful piece by Dawn Wallace, who is from the Alaska Northwest Coast area, a woman holding a seal using fossilized ivory again.
Wow.
Completely different style than the Southwest, of course. This other piece, which you just cannot believe until you get up really close to it, It's a house. It's a hunting lodge. And if you look in the window of the hunting lodge, you will see the hunter in there. If you look at the lower quarter of it, under the ice, you will see an agate fish. You'll see an eagle in the branches. And if you had a magnifying glass, in the way in the background, there are all these little dots. Other birds are coming in or leaving. If I turned it differently, you would see water in the barrel. There's a rain barrel outside, and there's a piece of turquoise in there.
My goodness. And how old is that piece?
These are all new in the last year. The first piece I showed you was made for me. This one, I just grabbed it up. This is by Sarli Palaka, a brilliant artist whose work I've admired for years.
So, are bolo ties more of a finer craft? I mean, do you have to... They're not mass marketed anymore, are they?
Yes.
They are mass marketed.
If you go on the internet, you'll find bolo ties from $10 and up, brand new pieces. Of all quality, just like any art form.
Yeah.
There's expensive ones. You want to spend $10,000 or $16,000 or $35,000, you can do that. These are not in that range yet. But they come in all, just like any other Native American or non-Native art form, they come in all qualities and all styles and all prices.
How many bolo ties do you own?
Well, most of my collection, the best of my collection, is now the property of the Heard Museum here in Phoenix. And so they get the good stuff. These are pieces I've acquired since they collected that for the exhibit.
But you have hundreds, thousands? How many?
I had over 1,000.
Did you really?
Yes, but some of them weren't so exciting. I'm only showing you the good ones.
Yeah, of course. Friends, family, do they say, Norman, you've gone off the deep end with these bolo ties. What are you doing?
No. They know me. It's way too late for that. I guess it's a family philosophy. Anything worth doing is worth overdoing. And it's not just about collecting. I mean, if this were about collecting, I wouldn't be here. This is about education, research, the fact that we have taken a collection, merged it with a beautiful collection at the Heard Museum, written a book, put on a show. We're teaching people about what this is all about. The front and the back of the bolo ties, the history of them.
Real quickly, that's twice now you've mentioned the back of a bolo tie being important. What's so important about the back of a bolo tie?
The fitting. Most people don't care, of course. This is an unusual fitting in the style of Victor Cederstaff, who from Wickenburg, who is one of the people associated with the early bolo ties.
There we go.
And he patented this fitting. The other one is just a simple bar of silver cut out, but I don't have examples with me, but there's some mass manufactured fittings known as the Bennett clip, where mass produced. It says Bennett patent pending.
Yeah.
He actually never patented, he just put that on to scare off the competition, and we're still searching for Mr. Bennett.
I feel like we're on Antiques Roadshow here. You're telling us a lot more about bolo ties than I even thought existed. Before you go, though.
Yes.
Is it bolo tie or bola tie?
It is both. Actually, it is bolo, bola, string tie, Texas tie, lariat tie, yoke tie. All of these have been applied in written advertising, in patents. The Bola Tie Society, the fabulous Bola Tie Society, who helped make this the official state tie, believes in the bola word. But they have been overcome by history. The most popular phrase on the internet today is bolo.
All right. Well, we'll leave it at that. We can call it anything you want, but it's absolutely beautiful stuff.
Thank you.
Good to have you here. Thanks for
joining
us.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.